printed word. The Printed Word, a weekly program exploring the world of books. Every Wednesday evening at 7, The Printed Word examines an interesting literary personality or event. And now, your host.
This is Fred Lerner speaking. Today, The Printed Word begins in a regular series exploring science fiction. Our guest on this program is science fiction author and editor John W. Campbell, Jr. Mr. Campbell has written Who Goes There, which was made into the movie The Thing, and has been the editor of Analog, formerly Astounding Science Fiction, for over 25 years. In this connection, he has edited two collections of stories, the Astounding Science Fiction Anthology and the recently published Prologue to Analog. Let us begin by asking, what is the relation of science fiction to so-called mainstream literature?
You know, that designation, mainstream literature, is pretty much of a self-anointed sort of term. Who decided it was mainstream? Who decides what literature is? You know, it's awfully difficult to talk about anything until you first got some terms that have a definite meaning. So you know what it is you're talking about. What is literature? Now, one definition I've seen is that literature is the best expression of the best thinking. There are a lot of other definitions, no doubt, but just consider that one for a moment. And what was Einstein's original paper on relativity? Literature? It was certainly the best expression of some of the world's best thinking. Or was Darwin's The Origin of Species, was that literature? It was the best expression of some of the best thinking the world has known. What is mainstream literature? Now, one thing, you know, in essence, science fiction consists of stories about human adventures anywhere and any when, any time, and any place, not just on this earth, and not just in the present. You come down to it, and what they call mainstream literature is actually a subdivision of science fiction, because it deals only with here and now, a very narrow part of the total field of human experience. Again, what do they mean by literature? I don't know. I've never been able to understand very clearly. James Joyce and so forth, they get a big play, tremendously important. This is literature. But, you know, I want to question that. Let's look at the few pieces of human literature that have survived for more than the lifetime of their immediate contemporaries. There's one piece of human storytelling that was able to survive and leap every barrier of culture and language for 3,000 years. It was a story written about, by barbarians, people who lived in mud-floored huts. And yet that story is on sale in a paperback edition in the modern jet airports. Now that's literature. A story that can vault over every barrier of time and language and culture. It's called the Odyssey. That is literature, and that's a saga, and that was science fiction. It was the science fiction of its day, wasn't it?
Well, what would you call the stories in a magazine like Analog, if not science fiction?
They definitely are science fiction. That's what science fiction is. Stories of other times and other places. The implications of what we're doing today on the future, and a study of the past and what implications it had in today's world. Homer's Odyssey was a form of science fiction. It was exploring strange worlds.
Well, you will admit, though, that what is written as science fiction nowadays is different from the usual form of literature that you'll find in a regular magazine.
Sure. But may I say that the difference is that science fiction has a broader sweep a greater field. It's a more open mind. It is not limited to the narrow, conventional, little, petty, suburban ideas. It's got more of the sweep of the old sagas, more of the space and room to roam and to think that the old stories had, the stories that have been the literature of the world, not just of one place and one time.
Well, then, if science fiction appeals to the higher mind than, or the different mind than the suburban mind, why don't liberals, for example, beatniks, the sort of people who fancy themselves above the suburban type of mind, why don't they read science fiction?
Because one of the essences of good science fiction is a hard, solid mental discipline. You start recognizing that a human being is not the biggest thing in this universe. For one thing, the concept of God is not very popular with the beatnik type, generally because it implies that there is something more important than his own personal opinions and his own personal ideas. The essence of science fiction is there are things in this universe that are bigger than men and their ideas, their opinions, their beliefs, that there are things that we have to learn, that we can't impose our will on the universe, that we have to learn to work with it. Somehow this doesn't appeal to the beatnik.
I've read several such stories which seem to be, to some people, sacrilegious. For example, Robert Heinlein's newest book, Stranger in a Strange Land, has offended many people by what appears to be a lighthearted reference to religion.
That was not published in my magazine. That was published as a book. I disagree with Heinlein and a number of his approaches there. However, let me say this. What constitutes religion is one of those things that varies in time and place. Remember that Socrates was executed because he was irreligious, according to the mores of his time and place. We don't have to agree on what religion is, but I think it's necessary to agree that there is something in this universe that's bigger than man, more important than a human being's convictions, that we must admit that the universe is bigger than we are and that we must learn from it. That's the essence of religion, isn't it? Whether you call it the universe or God or Zeus.
Well, I have noted that most science fiction writers are devout religious people. To move on to another thing, who would you say was the first writer of modern science fiction?
Depends on what you mean by modern. As I have mentioned, Homer, after all, was writing science fiction of his time, exploring strange worlds. In essence, Gulliver's Travels was science fiction, exploring strange worlds. In those days, of course, they didn't think in terms of spaceships because they hadn't completed exploring this planet. So Gulliver was shipwrecked. The modern science fiction era has them space shipwrecked. It doesn't make any difference. The essential theme is there. But of the truly modern science fiction, I think this may surprise some people, Rudyard Kipling did a number of excellent science fiction stories. Matter of fact, there are some Rudyard Kipling stories that I would publish in the magazine today if they were submitted. I don't know of any other man writing before 1925 whose stories I would publish in the magazine today. Specifically, Kipling did some stories about what he called the ABC, the Aerial Board of Control. One was With the Night Mail, and the Night Mail was a transoceanic airliner. Some of his stories, Naught-Naught-Seven and The Ship That Found Herself, are almost science fiction. I think he would qualify as the first of the modern science fiction writers.
And then I feel it's significant that Kipling is probably the most quoted poet among science fiction writers, and his characters, for example, are often alluded to by Robert Heinlein or many of the other well-known science fiction writers.
He was a writer of sagas. He was also a writer familiar with more than one cultural pattern. Most modern writers can really think only in terms of one cultural pattern. Have you ever read Kim? Kipling's
Yes.
Kim.
Yes, I have. It's been one of my favorite books by Kipling.
In there, you encounter and think with a Tibetan Lama, a boy brought up in the bazaars of Lahore, an Afghan horse trader. In there, you are encountering more than one cultural pattern. Now, this, in essence, is what the science fictioneer is trying to do. So Kipling is quite a favorite with the science fiction people.
Well, I spoke very recently with the American secretary of the Kipling Society, and he told me that one of the major characteristics of Kipling, the reason why he's so admired, is because of his versatility. I've noticed that several science fiction writers have set their stories in either the present or very near future, but in different cultures. For example, Mac Reynolds is running a series of stories in your magazine on Africa. I've noticed also that Analog tends, more than many other science fiction magazines, to be interested in such things. Could you tell me why this is?
The real problem that men need most to solve today is the problem of cultural difference, and to understand the underlying fundamentals that make different cultures equally human. For instance, our great trouble today is with the communist culture versus what we have in this country. If each side could truly understand the human basics of the other side, there wouldn't be so much conflict. Science fiction gives us an opportunity to explore the consequences of different cultural postulates. You know, every culture is based on postulates. What they call the inalienable rights of man. There is no such thing as a right. There's only what you can earn. There is no such thing as free freedom. There's only the freedom you earn. That's why they always say that if you want freedom, you must be willing to fight for it. Each of us has postulates. Now, in science fiction, we have the opportunity to explore an alternative postulate and see how that, too, can lead to a good and human culture. True, there are technical features that are going to come in. Those too must be integrated. For instance, some years back, a young man who was thinking of going into the craft of typesetting as a linotype operator, I strongly suggested that was a very poor field to go into because computers are going to take it over. There are going to be changes in our culture that stem not from changes in the cultural postulates, but from changes in the cultural realities, such as the introduction of labor-saving devices that save mental labor, which is what the computer does. Now, that's something that science fiction can explore in a way that none of the conventional literatures ever attempt.
Well, in this program, I'm hoping to give people who usually don't read science fiction, they don't know too much about it, a general idea of what science fiction is and of why they should read it, why it is so interesting. So I would like to clarify, first of all, what we mean by science fiction a bit more. For example, how would you differentiate between science fiction and fantasy?
That's a little more difficult distinction to make. The best way I can define it, I think, is this. In a true science fiction story, the author introduces one new postulate, and from there on, the rules of the game require that he develop a consistent story, consistent with the known facts of science. He is limited by the disciplines of known facts. In a fantasy story, anything goes. There are no limitations. A fantasy is like a dream. Anything can happen. A science fiction story is an effort to extrapolate from the way things are going now. It appears that things will be in this and so. Typically, science fiction back in the early 30s was discussing rocket ships, atomic power, things like that. At that time, that was called fantasy. Well, it wasn't fantasy. It was science fiction. It wasn't fantasy because this was no baseless dream. This was a projection of what was probably going to happen.
I've heard stories about science fiction writers in the 30s and early 40s writing stories about the atomic bomb, for example, which in many ways predicted the actual atomic bomb before it came, and that some of these writers were visited by agents of the FBI or military intelligence and asked where they got their information. Is that true, or are these apocryphal?
That one is quite true. As a matter of fact, they weren't so much worried about our predicting the bomb. That we'd been doing for a decade or more. What bothered them was that we had described it with great accuracy. As a matter of fact, the story by Cleve Cartmill, titled Deadline, had a description of the arming mechanism of the uranium bomb that was more accurate than anything that appeared anywhere up until the time of the Green Glass spy trial disclosures. And that came out in 1944, more than a year before the Alamogordo test. Well, when that appeared on the stands, the Pentagon sort of blew its stack, because it looked as though someone had really been blowing his mouth off, and that our author had overheard him in a bar or something like that. So they naturally did some fast investigating. The answer is quite simple. It took the physicists several years to build the hardware to do what they knew theoretically could be done. The advantage of the science fiction writer was that he didn't have to build the hardware. He just expressed what could be done. And he came to exactly the same conclusions the physicists had. He had the right answer. And because he didn't have to build the hardware, we got the story published a couple of years before they were ready. That's happened before, and it's happened in other instances that... Well, there have been stories that I have not published and suggested strongly to the author that he not try to get published. Every now and then, they predict something that I know about and know is under top security.
Could you tell me something about the changes you have noticed in science fiction from, say, the 1930s to the present time?
There have been changes. One of the major changes has been the development of a group of authors who have grown up in the field, and the inevitable influx of men who see that here is a means of presenting ideas that they want to present. What has happened is the steady improvement of the level of thinking and the steady increase in the detailed analysis. Let me put it this way. I figure that our customers, our readers, put their 50 cents on the counter to pay the authors to do something for them. Now, what does a man want to pay an author to do for him? Either the author must think of an idea that the reader never thought of himself, or he must think through an idea with a degree of detail that the reader never had the time to think through for himself. Or he must think it through and come to a conclusion that the reader had never recognized. And many times the reader doesn't like that conclusion. But if the author has done a good job on telling his story, the reader will say, well, I don't like it, but he's right. I'd never thought of that. That makes a good story. This has developed more and more in the 30 years or so that we've been working on it.
You mentioned that there were a group of writers who had grown up in science fiction. Could you mention some of these people by name?
Well, when I started down at Astounding Science Fiction, back in the late 38, there was a kid who came down to see me. He was a undergraduate student here at Columbia. A kid by the name of Ike Asimov. He is now Dr. Isaac Asimov, professor of biochemistry up at Boston University School of Medicine. He's grown up in science fiction. He's had a great deal to do with the development of science fiction. Some of the newer authors who are writing stories for us now weren't born when this magazine of mine really got started. These men have really grown up in science fiction. They've really learned a lot. And they're using the old science fiction as a basis. Naturally, there's been an improvement, a great change.
What do you think science fiction stories will be like in coming years?
Wish I knew. If I knew, I could go about getting them now, couldn't I? Now, part of the business of an editor, he is sort of trying to act like a telephone line, extending 6 months or so into the future. See, there's about a six-month time lag between the time I read a story on my desk and the time I hear from the readers what they thought of that story. I have to guess today what the readers are going to say 6 months from now and base my story buying on that basis. The best authors are those that surprise you. They do a story, and after you've read it, you say, yeah, I never thought of that. That's a heck of a good idea. In other words, the authors are continually showing me what could be done in science fiction by doing it. I never know.
There's a question about writing science fiction that's always interested me and several other people I've talked to. And as you've been a writer, perhaps you could tell me, just where do you get those ideas?
Anywhere. Anywhere and everywhere. Matter of fact, one of the ideas I used in one of my earliest stories was supplied me by Dr. Norbert Wiener, the MIT professor who's known for his work in cybernetics. Well, that was back in 1931. I have gotten ideas from a garage mechanic who was complaining about the poor design, the poor approach of design. I've also gotten ideas from reading a textbook and saying, well, you know, I don't think he's right because it could be this way. And then you write the story. No telling where you're going to get an idea.
Could you recommend some books recently published as science fiction for our listeners?
Well, remember, I'm not a book reader. Look, I have to read every manuscript that comes into the magazine. I don't have a first reader, a second reader, or anything else. I do it all. I have to. Because it has been proven by being tried and it doesn't work, that you cannot get a first reader. Well, by the time you read what is known technically as the slush pile, you're really not interested in doing much extra reading. I haven't read any of the books that have come out that didn't come out first in my magazine. I just can't do it. You know, there's a limit to this busman's holiday idea.
I see. Well, then, could you mention some authors who would serve as a sort of easy introduction to science fiction for readers who aren't used to it but who would like to learn more about it?
Depends on which direction they're coming into science fiction from, let's say. For instance, a physicist who hasn't read science fiction before, I might get quite a kick out of the work of a science fiction author by the name of Fred Hoyle, who is one of the world's top cosmologists, as you may know. He's written some science fiction books.
Didn't he write A for Andromeda?
Not particularly. He had a hand in it, but that wasn't really his work. He wrote The Black Cloud, I believe, and he's done some others. But if you're coming into the field from the literature side, usually people think of Ray Bradbury as a science fiction author. Now, he's not really. He's a fantasy author. But it'll give you some introduction to some of the background thinking. Bob Heinlein has done some mighty good stuff. As I say, Rudyard Kipling did some excellent science fiction. It's fully worth reading today. Incidentally, when that story with the night mail first appeared way back in the 90s, the issue of the magazine it first appeared in, they had some fun. They ran with it a bunch of advertisements. They were advertisements made up as of the period of the story, which was laid at the end of the 20th century. Advertisements for flying machines and so forth. This was appearing in an 1890s magazine. They had some fun with that one. There's a lot of good science fiction being published. I just can't keep up with it all, that's all.
Well, thank you, Mr. Campbell. Our guest today has been John W. Campbell, Jr., science fiction author and editor of Analog Magazine. This is The Printed Word, Fred Lerner speaking.
You have been listening to The Printed Word. The Printed Word is produced by Andrew Tashman and is recorded through the facilities of WKCR. Tune in next week for another excursion into the world of books. John Campbell speaking. This is King's Crown Radio.